We'll have a brief look at telescopes, okay, that we use at X-ray and gamma ray wavelengths, and see what are the issues that we face over there. So telescopes will put X-rays and gamma rays together over here, although you'll see that as we go to higher energies, the techniques change. Again, you can see over here, this is the same slide which you discussed earlier, just to remind you of the energies that are involved, okay? X-rays from about 120 electron volts to about 1.2 into 10 to the power of 5, which is about 120 kilo electron volts, and gamma rays higher than that, right? Now, from the discussions we have had so far, would you be able to sort of say a little bit on whether we can have an X-ray telescope like an optical telescope, have some lenses and focus it onto a CCD? What do you think?
I don't think glass would refract X-rays that much. So I don't think you could have an X-ray telescope.
Okay. Okay, anybody else? Ekta? Ahan?
I agree with Akino. I don't think you could use a regular glass lens at any rate. You'd have to have some sort of a special setup that'll interact with X-rays differently.
Okay. Ekta, you agree with them as well?
Yes, sir.
Okay. We'll see whether you're right or wrong. Okay. But first, before I go into sort of discussing your answer, okay, we will briefly look at, this is a brief recap of how we would detect the photons, because these photons we basically detect by interactions of photons with matter. So to just remind you, photons have zero mass, zero charge, and the maximal velocity is the velocity of light in vacuum. Right? Okay. Photons, as you know, have energy and momentum. They may have zero mass, but they have energy and momentum. Electrically neutral, so they do not lose energy by Coulombic interactions. But they can transfer energy entirely or partially, usually to an electron, and the electron will deposit energy in the medium. So the physical processes by which lose energy, just to recap, this is something you are familiar with, the photoelectric effect, Compton scattering, and pair production, okay? So what is the photoelectric effect? Where photon undergoes an interaction with an electron, okay? And the energy of the electron is the photon energy minus the binding energy of the electron to the atom. So energetic electron is emitted from one of the bound shells of the atom. So the cross-section increases with the atomic number, okay, and decreases with photon energy. The exact values depend on the energy ranges, etc., but it increases with the atomic number and decreases with photon energy. Increases with depth, decreases with E photon. And it is probabilities are enhanced when most likely when photon energy just exceeds the binding energy of the electron. So that's why you get sharp edges corresponding to the K or L shell. And this is predominant at lower energies. We'll look at the cross sections, a figure in a short while, of 0.1 to 10 keV. And when an electron goes back to a lower energy level, transition to a vacant lower energy level, you get an emission line as well, which is called fluorescence lines. So photoelectric effect, Compton scattering, we talked about a little while earlier when we were discussing about the inverse Compton effect. Here, incident photon is scattered by an electron. So photon transfers energy to the electron, electron recoils, and the recoiling electron is called a Compton electron. And the transfer of energy is maximum when the electron is scattered back along its path. In this illustration over here, which I took from the book by Rubicki and Lightman, theta is this angle over here. This is the initial direction of the photon. This is the scattered photon. So theta is the angle it makes with the initial direction. Okay. The energy of the scattered photon is given by h nu prime is equal to h nu divided by 1 upon 1 plus alpha 1 minus cosine theta. alpha is the ratio of the photon energy divided by the response energy of the electron, which is 0.511 MeV. Okay, h nu is the energy of the incoming photon. And EE is the energy of the Compton electron. Okay. Now you can see that h nu prime, that would be a minimum when cosine theta is minus one, that is theta equal to 180 degrees when theta is going back. And that will be the case when EE Compton electron is a maximum. One can calculate and show that this is a max, this that more energy is transferred when the incoming photon has a higher energy. So just substitute.
Teacher, when you say scattered back along its path, do you mean, does it mean it reverses direction or it's
reverses direction? For example, when I say theta equal to 180 degrees, the photon is coming here and the photon is gone back, right? Theta equal to 180 degrees would refer to that. Okay, is that all right, Aquino?
Okay.
Okay, and that would lead to the minimum value of the scattered photon, h nu prime, and that would lead to the maximum energy of the Compton electron. Okay. Now, we have written down these expressions for theta equal to 180 degrees. And I just want to demonstrate to you that the fraction of energy which is transferred depends quite strongly on the energy of the incident photon. The alpha is the ratio of the energy of the incident photon to the response energy of the electron. You can go and calculate that, look at it more leisurely as well. And you can calculate h nu prime and check that I've got my numbers correct. You'll get 5.01 keV. 5.11 becomes 5.01 keV, and the energy of the electron is 0.10 keV. We're just plugging in these numbers over here. So the fraction of energy which is transferred, this is only 0.1 divided by 5.11, which is roughly about 2%. So at low energy, photon energies, a small portion of the energy is transferred, whereas at high energies, here I have gone up by 3 orders of magnitude from kilo electron volts to mega electron volts. When I do that, alpha becomes 10. The scattered photon h nu prime becomes 0.24 MeV, okay, from 5.11 MeV. And the energy of the electron becomes 4.87 MeV. And you can look and see that this is a huge fraction. 95% of the photon energy is transferred to the electron. So higher the energy, more energy gets transferred. And the other process we have talked about is photon interaction with matter, that as long as it is greater than 1.02 MeV, it can create electron-positron pair. These are not electrons from which are existing. These are de novo electron-positron pairs by the high energy photons. And because the response energy is 0.51 MeV, you require at least greater than 1.022 MeV to be able to create that electron-positron pair. But usually the photons would have a range of energies, and extra energy will go into the kinetic energy of the electron-positron pair. And the probability of pair production increases with increasing photon energy, and it also increases with atomic number. Now, these processes become important at different energy thresholds, okay? And we'll see how that becomes important. Now, all of you, Ekta, Ahan, and Aquino, you'll say that you can't refract like an ordinary sort of optical light with a lens, and that is absolutely correct. But X-rays, we can still, what we can do is that we can try and reflect them off mirrors with sort of grazing incidents. It's like, I don't know if some of you have tried it in your younger days or even now, by throwing a stone on a lake at a very small grazing angle, and the stone will skip, it would keep skipping the surface. And we used to compete as to how many skips you can get by throwing a stone on a lake at very strong, small grazing angle. Whereas if you drop it from, you know, vertically down, it'll go plonk and it'll go sink to the bottom. So what X-ray telescopes do is it ricochets off at grazing incidents. And incidence, angle of incidence is small. It is typically less than a degree or so. Okay. And critical angle beyond which reflection drops dramatically varies as the square root of the, as well as the energy of the photons. The more dense material have higher critical angles. So you can go a bit higher. At 0.5 degree angle of incidence, nickel, which is atomic number 28, and gold, AU, is Z equal to 79, cuts off R 6 and 9 keV respectively. Okay, so it is energy dependent and atomic number dependent. But what happens is that when you're going at grazing incidence, the projected areas are small, right? It's just a small annulus kind of thing for one set of mirrors. So many mirrors are required, and a mirror combination is often used to also reduce the focal point so that you can actually get it to a point. Otherwise, you can't sort of manage in space with huge sort of focal lengths. Otherwise, you'll have to have two spacecrafts which are very well coordinated, one reflecting the other, sort of receiving the reflected rays. But all of you are, you know, absolutely correct in saying that you cannot do it like optical light. But what we can do is have photons going off at grazing incidents. So this is actually the mirror assembly of the Chandra telescope we keep talking about, where they have nested paraboloids and hyperboloids to reflect the X-rays coming in at grazing incidents and get it to a detector over here. And if you recall that at 550 nanometers at optical wavelengths, we discussed how smooth the surface should be. And we saw that it was, you know, order of inches if you had a mirror the size of the Earth. At X-ray wavelengths, you're talking of even much smaller wavelengths. So once you have four concentric mirror cells at grazing incidents, the projected area would be annuli, you know, small annuli for the different lenses, and the average width is small. But even with an average width at the kind of wavelengths that you're talking about, your diffraction limit is very small. Okay, here I've written down 10 to the power of minus 2 arc seconds. Okay, so it's extremely small, even by looking at the small areas which are going to reflect the light. Chandra's resolution is typically about half an arc second, which is fantastic compared to what we have had in the X-rays in the past and even planned missions. But it is worse than the diffraction limit by a long way. And the challenge is in difficulty in polishing mirrors to the desired level. We saw how accurately you had to polish the mirrors. So if it is 1/10, the wavelength of the radiation that you're receiving, you're looking at nanometer scales. So you can imagine the kind of technology which is required to polish mirrors to that level of accuracy. So it's a huge technological development, achievement to be able to actually get sub-arc second resolution at X-ray wavelengths. Maybe one technology will develop to form sort of new reflectors at grazing incidents and we'll do better. But once you have the incident photons, you need to detect them. And there are, in different energy ranges, different processes are used. Usually the photon, there's a photoelectron which is accelerated by fields to these dynodes. And there's literally a cascade by putting appropriate voltages that you build up a cascade of electrons, which gives you to a pulse of electrons, which we read out. So photomultiplied tubes have been, you know, standard for a long time, where high energy photons knock off an electron by the photoelectric effect. So we just discussed what the photoelectric effect is, something that you're familiar with. And the electrons are focused to the electron multiplier. So this is like an amplifier for the radio waves that we talked about earlier, because the number of photons that you receive are quite small. So, and then you get the secondary electrons and you read out a pulse at the end. Besides photomultiplier tubes, today charge couple devices are also used in modern X-ray telescopes. And calorimeters or bolometers are also used where the incoming photons are converted to heat and temperature rise will depend on the energy and number of photons. And you need very accurate thermometers to be able to measure that. And to reduce other sources of noise, these are usually kept at very low temperatures. So that is a very brief sort of introduction to X-ray telescopes. I'll just give you very briefly about gamma ray telescopes as well. As we mentioned, low and medium energy, 100 keV to 30 MeV, high energy 30 MeV to 100 GeV, and very high energy 100 GeV to 100 GeV. And as you all correctly mentioned, that above a few MeV, there is no effective way of focusing a photon beam. So in these cases, your detectors are effectively the size of the gamma ray telescope. So they're small in size. Ideally, if they were bigger, they would be able to collect more photons because the photon flux is small, as you just mentioned, but it is not easy to put up huge arrays or telescopes in space. And for these energies, we need to go out of the atmosphere to detect the gamma rays. And as we discussed, for the very high energy gamma rays, we try to use the atmosphere itself as a detector via Cherenkov radiation. So in different energy ranges, which where the cross sections are optimal, we use different effect to detect the gamma ray photons. That is all you need to remember. Don't worry too much about the details, although I will give you a bit more information in case some of you are more interested. So it essentially depends on the cross section of interaction with matter to avail of the different effects to be able to detect the incoming high energy photons. Photoelectric effect, as we saw, was interaction of gamma rays with electrons. Compton effect, you know, unbound electron takes up energy and momentum of gamma ray photon, and the photon loses energy. So if you can detect these electrons which have interacted with the gamma rays and the photon keeps losing energy as it interacts, then when you go to higher energies, the cross sections for pair production is large. So you want to be able to detect the pairs of positrons and electrons that are generated. And threshold of interaction, as we just mentioned, has to be at least greater than the rest mass energy. If it is lower than that, you will not be able to generate this pair of electrons. And the cross sections are again dependent on where this electron proton positron pair is generated. You'll find that it is larger, closer to the nuclear regions where there's strong fields. And at very high energies, we use the atmosphere as a detector and we have Earth-based telescopes. This basically illustrates the same aspects which I verbally mentioned a little while earlier, but we will just mention it over here again. This gives the cross section, okay? And this is the sum of cross sections of different processes which take place. This is shown for carbon and for lead. Z is 82 over here and Z is 6 over here, okay? And you can see that this is the cross section for the photoelectric effect, which is given over here, which is important at low energies. Okay. Now, once you go to slightly higher energies, you need to avail of the Compton effect. And once you go to higher energies still, you can see the cross section is optimal for pair production. Okay. Pair production over here. And you can also look at the differences when you see between Z equal to 6 and Z equal to 82, right? So these are different atomic numbers for the cross sections for these processes. And when you go outside this scale over here at the highest energies, greater than 100 GeV, then we make use of these atmospheric showers. And these detectors, which you by these processes, physical processes, we have either generated electrons, positron pairs, we have knocked off electrons generated to high energies, or we have created photons by that process. And the way we detect it is if the X-ray is converted to light, then we have a photodiode, an electric circuit which will detect the photodiodes, and we can reconstruct an image from that. If it generates a current, electrical signals, then the electric circuit will detect the current and we form an image from it. This is trying to put it very, very simplistically, okay? When we want to try and actually build detectors, there are various aspects you'll have to deal with, including trying to ensure that cosmic ray particles are not doing the same thing to your equipment. So you need to shield them. You also have, counters, anti-coincidence counters to make sure that it is the photons you're interested in that you are really going to count. And you can see, and this particular illustration shows you a photon generating electron positron pairs, which gets later detected by a counter at the bottom. These are illustrations of the first two, the initial two gamma ray astronomy satellites, which I mentioned earlier, the small astronomy satellite by NASA and COSP by ESA, operating from KeV to GeV ranges, in this case from MeV to GeV ranges, which have given us the first images of the gamma ray sky, discrete objects, pulsars, as well as diffuse emission from the galaxy. So one of the first dedicated satellites to explore the gamma ray sky, which actually yielded a lot of interesting results, was the Cosmic Gamma Ray Observatory, which operated from 1991 to 2000. And one of the very important experiments was over there was the Energetic Gamma Ray Telescope experiment called EGRIT, which went from 20 MeV to 30 GeV. They had a spark chamber over there, and the photons, the positron pairs which get created were later tracked and detected. And usually these are detected at the bottom over here, and that is where they're counted and measured to try and estimate what the gamma ray flux is. We'll avoid the details over here, just be aware of the physical processes. Now, often the direction from which the gamma ray comes is very poorly determined. For example, if you had just a gamma ray telescope over here, which saw the photons coming, that it would be very difficult to say which part of the sky is coming from, because the solid angle that is being subtended would be very large. You can enclose it in a cylinder, narrow the angle, make sure other cosmic rays don't come through that, and try and count your gamma ray photon. That would help a little bit. But another interesting way to actually try and look at that was to look at the gamma ray from two particular scatters, so that you can try and project it back and you can see the gamma ray has come from the ring over here. So these are sort of some of the attempts to try and get a better handle on the direction from which the gamma ray photon is coming from. So they have two detectors in series. The upper one, Compton, scatters the incoming photon. The lower one should absorb it, and locations and interactions in both are recorded to try and get a better handle on the direction from which we get the signal, the gamma ray photon. COMTEL is a gamma ray observatory which operates from 0.8 to 30 MeV. Again, let's not worry about the details, but scintillators and photomultipliers, which we talked about earlier are used in trying to narrow down the direction from which the photons have come. Basically, it is a challenge to try and get high angular resolution at high energies because we can't focus them with a lens like we can do at optical wavelengths or focus them in the field like in radio wavelengths. We can't really do that over here. We have to just detect the photons directly as they come. So one of the interesting techniques which was developed was to have a coated mask in the detector. So what the coated mask does is you can think of making a coated mask even at optical wavelengths and just shine it to the sunlight and it'll form a pattern on the ground. Okay. Now, obviously, if the light came from different directions, the pattern would be shifted. And from that, you try to reconstruct what the direction might be. So this is another improvement which took place in terms of trying to find out the direction from which the gamma ray photons have come. Now, one disadvantage of that is that you're blocking off some of the photons to try and get a better sense of direction. So if you have weak gamma ray sources or very low number of photons, then this will not really work because you want a large number of photons to be able to detect it and try and infer the direction from it. So once then you have detectors underneath that to try and determine the flux, etc. But coated masks has been used to try and get a better handle on the gamma ray sky. So this actually just shows you the progress that has taken place in the gamma ray observatories from the early launches of OSO3 in 1967, which barely sort of detected photons and said, well, there seems to be an enhancement in the galactic plane, so there is more emission coming from the galactic plane. And then we go on to COSB, which is this image over here from COSB. And that was, you can see that the small astronomy satellite did not last very long, although it detected pulsars, but COSB actually lasted several years. And this was the first image of the plane of the galaxy, really, which one could sort of heralded the excitements and beginnings of gamma ray astronomy. This was from EGRIT, which was launched in 1991. And this is Fermilab, which was launched in 2008. And this also gives you the images of the gamma ray sky. So you can see that the telescopes have come a long way in terms of trying to localize sources and also increase in sensitivity with technology and innovative methods such as the coated masks. But when we come to very high energy gamma rays, greater than 100 GeV, the number of photons that you're getting is again extremely small. Okay. So Cherenkov radiation, as we discussed, is emitted when particles exceed the velocity of light in the medium. Okay. And these charged particles give rise to Cherenkov light and radiation, which these telescopes try to detect. So high sensitivity of VERITAS, which is very energetic radiation imaging telescope array system, is in the range of 50 GeV to 50 TeV. And as we have keep mentioning that, why not observe these high energy gamma rays from space? They're too few in number, okay, to be able to actually build huge dishes to be able to detect them. So typical gamma ray detection rate at these energies is about 10 to the power of minus 11 per centimeter squared per second. So one in a year, you get one photon in a year if you had an area of 1 meter squared. Okay, so you can see that, you need enormously large areas to be required to collect the photons. And that is very difficult to do from space. So what this does is uses the atmosphere as a detector. So the Cherenkov flash of light is collected by huge mirrors. And these huge mirrors are highly sensitive and mirrors, they deflect the light and a whole range of photomultiplier tubes over here, and which detects the signal. This is another one, which is in Kenya, in the deserts of Namibia. And again, you can see that you want to minimize stray light. So you put these up at the distant locations where your light pollution would be minimal. And But one issue you have to deal with over here is, what about cosmic ray particles? Because you have photons which are generating particles, and when the charged particles travel at velocities greater than the velocity of light in the medium, as Aquino also pointed out right at the beginning when he asked the question, that you have to deal with cosmic ray particles. How do you distinguish them? Because cosmic ray particles, we will look at it on the next class, and that will also generate cosmic ray showers. But there were clever ways of actually, people did simulations and worked out that, for example, the gamma ray particle would generate electron positron pairs, and that leading to a cascade. But they looked at the pattern that they would get from Cherenkov photons on the ground and from a proton shower. And they seemed to be able to distinguish them. Okay. They initially did this with numerical simulations and all that, but observationally also they've been able to establish. The other aspect of cosmic rays is that they don't come from any particular direction. Okay, for almost entire spectrum. Okay. So they are because even if they originate, say, in a particular energetic source like a supernova or a supernova remnant, that they would move around in the galactic magnetic field of our galaxy. And the magnetic field of a galaxy has a random component, and also a uniform component, but this random component is going to scatter these electrons in different directions. And when you look at the cosmic rays, they come from all regions of the sky. Whereas gamma rays, when you look at a particular source, your gamma rays are going to come from that source. So that is also helps you distinguish gamma rays, but the pattern of the air shower, the kind of photons that you receive on the ground from a cosmic ray shower, as well as a high energy photon shower, is slightly different.